Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of 27 letters to my daughter, written and read by Ella Ward. For my daughter, you are my bestest heart girl. Letter 1. 27 letters. My darling, you're holding this book because I can no longer hold you. It feels cruel that my last act as a mother was to die. I'm so sorry. It's the one thing, more than anything, I wish I could undo. However, as I look back on my life, there isn't much else I would change. But you'll come to see that. You'll see a lot of things, because in this book, I'm giving you everything. All of it. I haven't left a bit out. I have written 27 letters for you. In them are the lessons I've learned and earned in my life, all 188 of them. Lessons that have come from the monsters I've vanquished, the mistakes I've made and the loves I've forgiven, the adventures I've flown, the spells I've woven, the tears I've wiped. I've sewn them all together in these pages. Every word I've written is for you, to keep you and strengthen you and hold you. Now I cannot. I haven't written these letters alone. Did you know that our family comes with generations of words, captured and chronicled? And, oh boy, are they some words. My darling daughter, you come from a family of letter writers, nostalgists, storytellers, and people who quite like giving toasts at dinner parties. Or, as your great-grandmother put it to me recently, we are a family of people who believed they were important enough to write it all down. Important or not, it turns out that whatever I've been through in my life, someone else in my family has usually gone through it already. When I first began to read their words, this overlapping of experience felt like coincidence, but it soon grew into a regular occurrence. I've chosen to take great comfort in this serendipity. It means that these 27 letters are not only a gift from me, but from all of us. While everyone has a family, ours is a little more unusual than most. I hope these letters will not just hold you in my absence, but they'll also allow you to fall in love with these unconventional ancestors. Their words of wisdom have often been a comfort to me, but their sparkles of madness have always been a cure. I believe that being brave and kind and clever is one thing, but being all of those things with a twinkle in the eye is another, which is why I cannot wait to introduce them all to you. There's an American soldier who's fighting through Europe in 1918. There's also a woman running away from an elephant in Kenya in the 1960s. There's a man brandishing a pistol in World War II Shanghai and a teenager slopping through the mud on the last day of Woodstock. These are your relatives, and they all have lessons for you to add to mine. These letters will arm you with the knowledge, wisdom, and wonder of us all, because when push comes to shove, and death is dancing closer than you'd like, family becomes more important than anything else. We are a group of people who weren't dissuaded by little things like death, or war, or loss, or elephants. I am one of them, which means so are you. And so, now I am done and dead, and you are left with this, my all, to you, my everything. I love you, Mama. Letter 2. Introductions. What sets one family apart from another? What makes your family yours? Is it the curve of a nose that has echoed through generations? A tinkle in a laugh that goes up and down on a scale? Or is it something less tangible? A sense, a hum in your belly, a feeling of coming home? Family is all of those things, but none of them can exist without one important element. The telling of stories. A family is only as strong as the stories that are told. And, I'm afraid to say, the stories can't just be told, they need to be kept. One afternoon, I sat down with my great-grandfather Jim's letters from World War I. Tucked away in a locked-down house in the middle of a pandemic, I found myself eyeing the innocuous-looking green ring binder on my bookshelf. As the meme goes, our grandparents had to go to war, you just have to sit on the couch. I'd been sitting on the couch. I wondered what it felt like to go to war. Jim's letters from the front to his sweetheart, Kay, contained extraordinary stories. But then added to them was Jim himself. His words allowed me to live his wit, passion, raunch, pathos, and the small curious details he was surrounded by. As I read on, Jim became more real than any sepia-dusted photograph I'd seen. While we have Jim to thank for the stories themselves, it's Virginia, Jim's daughter, to whom I'm so grateful for passing them along. Virginia, my grandma, painstakingly transcribed her father's spidery, pencil-written letters and gifted them to me way back on my 24th birthday. They languished in various houses for 15 years. But 2020 was the year to complete my letters to you, and the year, it seemed, to read Jim's letters to everyone. One day, you're writing letters of love from the front. The next, your great-granddaughter is reading them from beyond the dawn of the 21st century. There's only one reason these stories have been able to travel so easily through time. Family. This is what family is, my girl. It's a passing on of responsibility, a collective agreement between those who sit on ever-widening branches of a family tree, an understanding that the lessons must be protected for the next generation. Family doesn't just require a history told, it requires a history held, passed on, so the newest members can look back and see, with a small gasp of recognition, just what special group of people they belong to. And this family, our family, has two very important things going for them. Yes, we've written it all down, but crucially, we've all kept it safe for the next generation, which is why this family can remain a home for me and you and for those who are still to arrive. It's how I managed to discover so many overlappings of experience. It's what has meant I can write my letters to you. I think it might be rude to talk about people without properly introducing them, but I know it's definitely rude to publish their private letters and memoirs, their fears and dreams, near deaths and true loves, without properly introducing them. So, these members of your family are the ones who wrote it all down and protected the words for the next line of the family tree. They are my great-grandparents, Jim and Kay, my grandma, Virginia, and grandpa, Buzz, my mother, Kate, and me. And of course, we all have you, and now you have all of us. Jim, Kay, Virginia, Buzz, and Kate have all written down their stories, their letters, and their lives. Over this past year, I have swum around in their words and filled myself up with their histories. I am dizzy on dust, and my fingers are papery from scanning. But this isn't just a collection of old stories swept into new letters, because anecdotes are wonderful, but they're also a dime a dozen. No, my sweet girl, I have a wonderful secret to let you in on. The tales this family have shared come with a very special magic. Bringing each of these stories together is playing five records all at the same time and realizing, alarmingly, that it's all harmonizing. Is this music or is this noise? Who cares? It sounds wonderful. Would you like to see how the magic works? How a family of storytellers have passed something special down the line? Come now, hold my hand. Let's begin. Grandma, Virginia. My grandmother, and probably the central reason all of these letters are here for you. The keeper of the family archives. It's fitting that she's the first voice we'll hear in these letters, other than mine, of course. The initial hello comes from her own room, and it comforts me that she clearly feels as fond of her first bedroom as I am of mine. We'll check back in with Grandma often enough, but there's one specific thing I want to share from this particular memory of hers, so you can begin to hear this magical harmony for yourself. It's around 1932, and she's about 5 years old. We're in California. Listen. The bathroom is all warm and steamy. Daddy's been shaving in here. I wish I'd got up in time to watch him cover his face with ivory soap suds and see the dent in his shoulder made by the German shrapnel. I know what shrapnel is, Daddy told me, but I don't understand a lot of things he told me about the war. Daddy is James A. Quinby, that Jim in that war, my great-grandfather, your great-great. And while little Virginia was considering the divot in her father's shoulder in the 1930s, back in 1918, Jim wrote to his sweetheart Kay, Virginia's future mother, about that very scar. I'm glad to be moving again. They took my bandages off yesterday, entirely cured except for a light dimple in my shoulder. Won't be able to wear a low neck for a while. My letters won't be so regular, but you'll know one thing will be regular. That's love. Jim. After Jim was Jim and Daddy, he was Grandpa. Although her parents took her all around the globe, my mother, Kate, would visit her grandparents back in the USA as often as she could. In 1969, she was 16 and dancing with her grandpa around his Palo Alto living room. Tobacco, ivory soap, wood polish, Daphne. I try hard to stay loose-jointed and fluid. At the same time, I'm concentrating on the tight-framed foxtrot. My bare foot is practically behind Grandpa's brown brogues, but I'm not worried. They never touch me. Can you see the magic? You see? Many different songs, but they're all blending just right. This family of yours, whether by genetics or design, has interlaced the very physical manifestations of memory through its own history and lessons. I find that I have done the same. Through all of my years, I can tug on a shred of smell, say, Daphne, on a midwinter's afternoon, and not only will my own memories come tumbling out, but more will follow behind. Memories that aren't mine, memories I'm just holding safe to pass along. In writing these letters for you, I have come to realise time is elastic and what feels like forever ago can suddenly be very present. Life goes by so, so quickly. Your family are people with a sense of joy, a taste for adventure, a predilection for drama, and the ability to understand that life is a matter of contrast. For generations, we have met misfortune with a determined curiosity and even, often, genuine cheer. And all the way through, we've decided we are not only important enough to write it all down, but we think you are important enough for us to keep sharing. This is why I love our family. This is why I have called upon them to help me send love to you, my daughter. This is why it's time for you to know where you have come from and where you may be heading. This is the first lesson for you, darling girl. Wrapped up in your very DNA is the ability to be courageous, clever and kind in the face of all kinds of fuckery. So gather hold of those DNA strands and jump on in. The water's fine. Lesson one. If you have a family, you have a story. Letter three. You have to start somewhere. This is a letter about beginnings, about the time when generations past appeared in this world, about the time when you appeared in this world, and about the way some of these tales have remained, though many have disappeared. Of the characters whose words are woven through this letter, I am the exception, for the rest of you were born in May, but I in August, a chill August day in Melbourne inside a dark Victorian hospital with red brick walls and windows that said, "Go away." Here you are. You are here. Fleshy and silken, fingers like deep sea anemones, blistered lips and hair like damp feathers. So pleased to meet you. I'm your mother. Mother! And I am at your service. That's my mother speaking. In August 1981, she had birthed her first child, me, and by arriving, I had made the 28-year-old woman a mother. Even though I was only a few hours old, hands moving like sea creatures as if I was still floating in her belly, she was asking me these questions only a mother could ask. Will you be happy? Will you be cautious? Will you shine? Will you love your life? I will keep you safe until you find out. Now, 40 years later, I believe it's only fair of me to answer them. Will you be happy? Yes. Not always, but enough. Will you be cautious? Yes, always. Too much, but that caution will end up saving my life. For a time. Will you shine? Not immediately, but I hope, eventually. Will you love your life? Yes, yes, most definitely. Even in the darkest days, I will love the parts of my life that are important. You, your father, the way the sun catches raindrops falling from a bridge. So I think we can agree this means that Mum held up her end of the bargain. She kept me safe until I found all of this out. Mum asked a final question in those grey pre-dawn hours, quiet in a room filled with new baby smells. Do I have to share you with other people? Of course she had to share. We all do. From the moment your baby leaves your body, you begin farewelling them. Sometimes willingly, sometimes not. It's the grief and wonder of being a mother, letting go a part of your soul. Lesson 2. When you love something more fiercely than yourself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.